An important property of V1, primary visual cortex, is orientation selectivity. So in V1, we find oriented receptor fields for the first time, at least in primates. In some other species, these occur earlier in the visual pathways. So whereas in the lateral geniculate nucleus and in the retina, cells responded best to circular spots of light, now neurons respond best for to a light or dark bar with a particular orientation. So the receptive fields are elongated and look more like this over on the right. That was a property discovered by David Hubel and Torsten Wiesel, who won the Nobel Prize for Physiology for their work in this area, recording from the visual cortex of cats. And the story goes that they were trying to set up recordings from cat visual cortex, and they were showing spots of light, which they knew from other work in retina and other species, tends to drive visual neurons. So they were trying to find neurons that would respond to these spots of light. And they were trying spots of light of different size, in different locations, different brightness, but they couldn't get any response from their cortical neurons. And they were getting very disheartened. Until one day, one of them happened to move a ruler in front of the projection screen where they were displaying these visual images to the neurons, and suddenly the cell started to respond. And at that moment, they realised that actually these neurons in visual cortex, in V1, were responding best to elongated line stimuli rather than circular spots. So here I have a video that's actually on YouTube of Hubel and Wiesel's pioneering recordings, and they're recording from a simple cell, we'll discuss later what that is, in cat visual cortex. You're going to hear crackling sounds when I play this video. What that is actually the neurons' action potentials. So Hubel and Wiesel, to make life easier for themselves, they've connected up the voltage that they're recording from this cell to a loudspeaker, so that when the cell fires an action potential, a little voltage spike, they get a crack sound on the loudspeaker. And so as they hear more crackling, they know the cell is firing more action potentials. And so this is an easy way for them to hear how responsive the cell is as they try different visual stimuli. And you'll see them playing around, trying to find what the cell responds best to. So this is the oriented light bar stimulus which they're using to try and drive this neuron and get it to respond well. So having found the location on the screen where the cell tends to fire a lot of action potentials when that bar appears, they're now going to mark that on. And you can see they're marking these little crosses to say, yes, that's an on region. The cell tends to fire lots of action potentials when this bright stimulus appears. See them trying to find out how far this on region extends on either side of the line that they've marked. They're marking these little triangles, which I think is them marking an off region of the receptive field. So they reckon that in this region, the cell is actually more likely to fire spikes when the bright bar disappears rather than when it appears. I find that less convincing than their on region, but there you go. Now, did you notice the clear orientation tuning of that cell? When they rotated the bar and moved it across the receptive field, you really got no response at all. The cell just doesn't like bars of that orientation. Whereas when they move it back to the original orientation, you get lots of action potentials. So this slide shows a kind of schematic diagram of the sort of experiment we saw Hubel and Wiesel doing. So you present stimuli of different orientations, lines, bars at different orientations, and you see how the response of the cell varies as a function of the orientation of the bar. So these are the spikes being fired by the cell. And over many repetitions of such experiments, you can plot the cell's average firing rate as a function of the orientation of the bar, and you'll get something like this. So it's called a tuning curve. You can see that the cell is responding most in this example for vertically oriented bars and least for horizontally oriented bars. They're really giving no extra spikes other than those you spontaneously get from the cell anyway. So this sort of orientation tuning curve can be used to characterize a cell. And I'll stress, this cell is tuned to vertical bars, but in general, a cell might be tuned to any orientation. Now, Hubel and Wiesel recorded from many neurons and recorded the preferred orientation of each neuron that they found. They recorded its tuning curve and from that, the preferred orientation. And they noticed something interesting when they did that. So what's going on here is a record of an experiment in which Hubel and Wiesel were advancing an electrode through cat visual cortex. So they stick the electrode in a bit, record a neuron. When they've characterized it, they advance the electrode a bit deeper into the brain, find another neuron, record that, move the electrode on, find another neuron, record that, and so on. And each dot in this plot represents one of the neurons they recorded. And they, on the y-axis, they're plotting the preferred orientation of that cell, so the peak of its orientation tuning curve, as a function of their distance that they've advanced the electrode into the brain. And you can see that adjacent neurons, neurons recorded one after another on the electrode track, tend to have rather similar orientation tuning preferences. So over the entire course of the experiment, they're finding neurons tuned to all sorts of different orientations, but the neurons are clustered together. Now, over subsequent years, people have worked out how those orientation selective neurons are grouped, and the answer is that they're grouped in columns. So this diagram shows a top-down view of cortex, color-coded by the preferred orientation of all the neurons down in cortex under that point. So green here represents neurons that are tuned to vertical bars, and red, say, to horizontal bars. And what you can see is that where you've got red on the surface of the cortex, all the neurons underneath that little patch of cortex in that column tend to be tuned to the same orientation. So here, vertical. And what was happening with Hubel and Wiesel is their electrode was going in slantwise through the cortex. So they were crossing through different orientation columns. And furthermore, as well as having the neurons arranged in columns, adjacent columns tend to be tuned to similar orientations. So you can see the colour code tends to change rather gradually from red to yellow to green to blue as you move through the cortex. As smoothly as it can. And then every now and again you get these regions, these little pinwheels, where all the different orientation tunings meet. And the reason for that is that as well as being grouped by their preferred orientation, neurons are also grouped according to the location of their receptive fields on the retina. So that's the property called retinotopy that we saw earlier. And the cortex is, or the brain is trying to group cells that are tuned to adjacent locations on the retina together, but also cells that are tuned to similar orientations. And it's trying to achieve that over the 2D cortical surface. And it's not possible to have both those things varying smoothly everywhere. And the solution the brain's come up with is that the location property varies smoothly, and you get these mainly smooth variations in orientation, but just with occasional abrupt transitions at these pinwheels. Orientation selectivity, therefore, is quite an interesting property of V1. It's the first area in humans and other primates where we find neurons that respond selectively to the orientation of a line stimulus. And a lot of people have thought that's pretty suggestive and have suggested that this is the basis of form perception, object recognition. To give an example of that, let's think about line drawings. Isn't it kind of remarkable that you all know this drawing represents a horse? Even though the pattern of light on your retina caused by this light drawing is completely different from the pattern of light and dark on your retina that would ever be caused by a real image of a horse. What you will notice, though, is that in this image of a real horse, obviously it's darker than its background, so you get these regions where the darkness of the horse gives way to the brighter background. And because objects tend to be relatively continuous, you can see that the boundary of that object is made up of little lines. And it seems that V1 has evolved to be sensitive to these edges and to pick them out and pass them on to other areas of the brain, which then process them and recognise this as a horse. We imagine that line drawings probably work because they also contain these edges which strongly activate V1 neurons. So V1 is passing very similar information up to the rest of the brain, and your brain is still able to process this and see that it represents this image of a horse. And so that's why line drawings are something you don't have to learn. Children can recognise them immediately, and they're common to all cultures. We find them in cave paintings, we find them in this ancient chalk drawing of a horse, the white horse of Uffington down in the south of England. And that seems to be because this is a convenient way of activating your primary visual cortex. How is it that neurons in V1 have these elongated receptive fields? Hubel and Wiesel proposed a model which is still basically accepted today. They suggested that several LGN neurons, so these little splodges here represent neurons in the lateral geniculate nucleus, all converge on the same V1 neuron in primary visual cortex. What's shown over here is the receptive fields of the LGN neurons on the retina. So they're these circularly symmetric on-center, off-surround neurons. But the receptive fields are offset from one another along a line. So this V1 neuron, if you want to find out what it responds best to, is clearly going to be something that drives this LGN neuron and this LGN neuron and this LGN neuron and this LGN neuron, so that all four of them are sending strong excitatory input. And you can see that a bar is going to do that really well because it's going to drive the on regions of all these LGN neurons. Yes, each one, it won't be quite optimal for any one LGN neuron because the bar will be extending into the off surround of the receptive field. But overall, given that you have all these neurons feeding into the same V1 neuron, you can see that a bar, an oriented bar, is going to be the optimal stimulus. And so the V1 receptive field is going to look something like this, kind of the average of all the LGN neurons. Hubel and Wiesel put that forward, and it's basically panned out. It's still accepted today.